Welcome. That is some pretty nice menu music. But time is fleeting. Let's get back into it. Now, as you may remember, last time we played, we ended up with voices in our head. Now, we don't know what's causing this. We don't know if it's killing us or if it will kill us.
Got it.
Well, that's a thing that happened.
My eyes are peeled.
Silence, celestial pig. God, the screen won't move. There it is. That's not disgusting. Maybe I should avoid touching those? I don't know. Wait, why are you still here? That's weird. Anything else? There. Okay, this is where we are. Yeah, we have to go through Veil with it to get to the Gilded Veil. It's just no other way. So be it.
Rest would be good.
Right, well, let's go ahead and do that then. They're only charmed for 10 seconds, and it only works on beasts. But that's still got potential to be really useful. it's nice and all, but we need to camp. Healing received. Movement speed plus one. Yeah, let's go with that. So... Oh, that's not weird. One second while I take care of something. All right, now, that's right, let's see. More camping supplies. Cross there.
Lava room. Be quickly and quietly.
Well, it doesn't seem like they're hostile. Again, they appear to be outlaws, so let's try to avoid dealing with that right now. It's way too many people. I wouldn't be able to deal with them as this. Well, maybe I could. See what else we've got here. overturned and abandoned wagon. I wonder if I can charm it and then just kill it. It doesn't go much further this way. Well, that's unfortunate.
Time to see and not be seen.
Wait, this too. Shattered pieces of crate are strewn across the dirt, along with a few muddy vegetables. Can't do a thing with those. This. There's a bear and something hovering over this corpse. The charm only lasts for 10.8 seconds. It'd be nice to blind this guy.
Lavaru, beyond seeking. Let's go! Let's go!
So that didn't go too well. That's right, we do have a level up to use, don't we? As promised, we're back. Took long enough, but I was doing some things on the side. So let's see. It's not here. It's not what I want. Let's see. Here we go. Veterans Recovery. This is what I chose out of the list of all of those skills. I know another one that I'm going to be getting too, but that's for later. This basically allows me to regenerate endurance in battle, which I could really use because I'm the only person right now. There was the option to be able to summon skeletons, but that requires 15 seconds in combat, which is basically 15 seconds of getting slapped while waiting to be able to use an ability to give myself tanks to be able to fight. It made no sense, so I decided to go with something more selfish for now, until we get a party together. We'll see how this fares against the bear. Let me just go ahead and save this. How long does this tangle foot? That's 5.5 seconds. Might be enough to cast another ability or magic. Okay. Well, that's not what I wanted. That's going to take some getting used to, it really is. Ah, okay. First, we're going to go with the Tanglefoot.
Ah. With rock!
That's kind of annoying. Dang it. Yeah, it doesn't even look like the charmed. Guess I'll have to try again. That's a quick save.
No problem. Moeth. Ixis. Anas. Let's go. Let's.
Wow. Oh, man. That is... I think I'll deal with the AI stuff off camera. But that... Oh, man. Okay, for certain, we're going to go ahead and quick save. Now, as you just saw, we... Basically, once the portrait fills up with red, it's indicating how much endurance we've lost. And we almost died. Ah, that is just... That was my first boss fight, but not boss fight, you know? And it felt pretty freaking good to get things to fall in line like that. Let's see how long we've been recording. Says it's been about 44 minutes. That's, of course, not counting. Well, that's also counting the time I spent in level up trying to decide what to get.
No problem.
Wait.
My eyes are peeled.
Do we die here? Figure drifts suspended in the musty air of the cavern. Its form and features blur and twist in cascading ripples of incandescence. You feel its energy eddying about your limbs, filling them with a heavy chill. Touch it. You reach out a hand for the spirit. In the moment of contact, you feel as if you have been struck a blow, head reeling as you tumble helplessly into a waiting darkness. Light blooms at the edge of your vision. You feel the sun at your back and the weight of a bow in your hand. You know suddenly that you have come a long way from the Vale hunting deer. Now you are standing before a cavern, and the darkness extends far into its depths. Even so, your friend strides out before you, his red cloak flapping at his heels. You follow, heart hammering in your chest as he leads you deeper into the cavern. There is a roar like thunder echoing around you. Fear seizes you, casts you stumbling back towards the exit, towards light and escape. You see a glint of steel, and there is a sudden, terrible flash of agony behind your knee. You scream, stumble, fall. Your thoughts are chaos, lanced with the pain, but in a moment of terrible clarity, you see your friend look back from the mouth of the cavern, his dagger daubed in crimson to match his cloak. And then there is a great dark shape above you. And then there is no... Oh, and then there is more pain. The vision recedes and you are thrown back into yourself with seemingly resentful force. The corpse lies at your feet and the specter lingers. In the span of energy between you both, you feel a sense of questioning, of confusion, of anger. Now, the guy killed him was supposed to have been his friend, right? Let's see. Like blooms, hunting deer. Your friend strides out before you. You can't say something like this when it clearly states the guy was a friend. I'm going to kill him. For a moment, the spirit seems to burn bright, and your head fills with a sickly triumph. The spirit seems to weaken with the force of its own exultation, growing fainter and fainter until you are alone once more. Find the man with the red cloak and then make his outsides match his insides or something like that. It was better in my head. Great sword. I've got better. Pokey pokey. Huh? Oh, that's you.
Got it.
Mice crawl through eye sockets and over femurs. Sure, why not? Suck it.
Yeah?
Here's the bit about the endurance versus health. It says the red fill on a character's portrait represents the loss of endurance. The bar to the left of their portrait represents the loss of health. The health bar will change color as it gets closer to zero. As you can see, mine is at half and is yellow. Terrible, just terrible. When health is lower than maximum endurance, the bar on the portrait will indicate the endurance. Wait. When health is lower than maximum endurance, a bar on the portrait will indicate that endurance is limited. That's weird. I don't really have anything I can do about the low endurance.
Time to see and not be seen.
I think it was very prudent of me not to run headfirst into those outlaws huddled around the pot. With that in mind, can you guess what I'm about to go do? Careful here. I haven't gone this far yet. There's a tent. That's all this then. My dear Nantan, please be safe. Know that whatever happens, I still love you. Yoink. What's this?
Hmm?
Northwest. So that's where we were. Cave is called Girin's Grasp.
Sure.
No. There's a corpse up here whose stuff I want. I also need to figure out how the endurance system works. let's see if I can... Well, I can't charm until I'm in battle. I can't buff myself either.
Lavaru.
No. Right. I can't use this again until... Okay. Can't use this again until I rest, and I don't have enough of the camping supplies to just do that whenever I feel like it.
Let's go!
Wait.
Let's go! Let's go!
Just like that, another stupid thing is done. Wait.
My eyes are peeled.
Sucks that I couldn't lure out one of them at a time.
Would you look at this?
Well, wow. Ooh. Aged walls appear to have once encircled this entire glade. Only a small fragment remains, and the stairs leading to the top of the structure have crumbled away. The heavy bricks are slick with moss, presenting a hindrance to climbing, but the stones themselves seem sturdy enough. Given the right tools, one might easily reach the top. Do it. You find a handhold upon one of the large stones and start to pull yourself up, but the uneven bricks and odd angle of ascent make the climb difficult, and after a short distance your arms begin to burn too fiercely. You are forced to drop back down to the ground. Geez, sucks that all of my party members were just killed off all of a sudden. Let's see. Not this. Right, I can't put on a helmet because my head is like this. You can even see the thing right here, locked. That's great. Well, that sucks. I didn't realize I needed to actually put... I thought this indicated that it was equipped, but at the same time, I also already realized that this was their personal inventory. And into the bag you go. Right, I found this by going back into the cave that we, right outside of which our allies were killed, just dropped dead. I went back into where the black ooze was that we fought, back into the opening, well, back into the alcove that opened after we inserted the gem into the head on the wall. I held the tab and there was a, sort of like you saw a moment ago, where there was this little thing on the ground that I otherwise wouldn't have realized was there without holding the tab button, which reveals interactables in the area. And that was some stones and this, which is a whole lot better than just having more deflect, for now at least. Maybe I should start with the crossbow to do some free damage from a distance, since I don't have the talent I want to equip just yet. 22, 29. Now see, the damage on here says exactly the same thing. Wait. That's its base. Yeah, so they say the same thing here, but remember before in the last video there was a discrepancy between what one said it did and what this would say it did. That's going to be interesting. Yeah, the crossbow does more damage than the two-handed axe. Speaking of items, considering making him a frontliner, but I don't know just yet. Well, let's keep that on him for now.
Time to see and not be seen. No problem.
Dang it, that's four of them. Hold on, let's... Yeah, I would need to rest first. Let's do that away from them. Since we quick save, using this is fine. What's this? That's not interesting. Yeah, we'll keep the damage reduction. This guy in particular concerns me. He doesn't have any visible weapons. Let's see. Ah, okay, so you can quick like that. I had a suspicion this would be the case because they weren't immediately marked as enemies. The young dwarf tending to the stew looks up, startled, as he sees you approach. He drops his ladle, spattering stew across the ground.
What?
The bandit turns. Get him, you dogs, and make sure our new cook don't run off.
Help, please. Help.
One of the bandits gives Tenfrith a kick as they pass him, and he huddles. I can use the stag's ability, but that means I need to get over here so that they'll all group up around this guy. First, I want to use this. Let's see. This will be fine. He's only got one, whatever that is, lever. And I believe in you. Okay, that's enough of that. Simple. I probably should have done this before I went into the cave, but here we are. Ooh, lots of stuff to touch. First off, though. Just gonna go ahead and do that. I guess using that when you're the only person sucks. Oh, so much stuff.
Well met, friend.
By the flame, thank you. Thank you, thank you. I thought I'd be stuck cooking for these ignorant weasels for the rest of my life. Or until they were bored with me, I suppose. I must get back home. I only hope they haven't hired a replacement. The dwarf looks aghast. Listen, next time you're in Gilded Vale, stop by the Black Hound Inn. I'll let Pasca know just what you've done for me, and I'm so sure she'll do right by you in turn. Haha, we now have a reputation.
No problem.
Way. Okay. Let's go ahead and quick save. We're coming up on the end of this video, so. And I'd really love to play more, but I don't want these episodes to be too long. Well, that is a terrible Christmas tree.
You must be one of the new settlers. Welcome to Gilded Vale. You'll be pleased to know that we've had some recent vacancies here.
I have no idea what this is supposed to be relating to.
Of course, we'll need to make some inquiries first. The inestimable Lord Radric the Seventh has taken great pains to insulate our town from Widewind's legacy. Have you ever sired a Hollowborn child?
I don't even know what that is.
An infant born without a soul, of course. Lord Radric has made it his first priority to eliminate this scourge from our village. I should warn you, stranger. Here in Gilded Vale, we have a special place for dissidents, charlatans, and those who would hide a curse in our midst. His lordship's wife is with child and due any day now. Without his approval, I shan't be able to find you a permanent settlement. It will have to wait until after the birth. We can continue our interview then, after the bell tolls from Radric's hold to signal my lord's new heir. In the meantime, you can find temporary accommodations at the inn just southwest of here. Whatever your problem, it sounds like a matter for an animancer. However, the only animancer in Gilded Vale isn't in any condition to speak.
Wonderful.
Consider yourself fortunate. After she failed Lord Radric, we saw to it that she wouldn't profit from the misplaced trust of others. A bad cure is often worse than none at all. But if you're set on finding a bottle of troll piss or a dead Audra pebble to rub on your forehead, you're welcome to check her pockets. A little corpse stink is nothing when you're digging for shit. My advice, however, is to be satisfied that you escaped and leave it at that.
Right. So, what is all this talk about Hollowborn and some idiot's legacy? Wonderful, another one that isn't voice acted. I forget that you foreigners do not have this curse in your homelands. The Hollowborn have been a scourge upon Direwood for almost 15 years now. He lowers his voice to a whisper. Children born without souls. He shakes his head. Pitiful, dumb things that breathe barely, but do not truly live. Some say the Hollowborn are a disease, some say they are a punishment from the gods. He raises his empty hands. In truth, no one knows, but they began spreading after the Saints' War, and so the name Widewind's Legacy stuck in honor of that foul, blasphemous pretender. Wonderful. I would imagine I probably shouldn't mention that ceremony. Because this guy's a dick, and I'm sure I'm going to end up killing him sooner or later. I just really don't like him.
Keep out of...
Listen!
Two tolls. Let that be the last.
Three. Gods have mercy.
It seems your arrival is ill-timed. Three bells toll only for the death of a Radric. I fear Lord Radric's heir is lost, or else Hollowborn, and so lost all the same. You should tread carefully. Circumstances have changed a great deal.
What do you mean? You come to us at a time of mourning. The legacy has struck at the heart of Gilded Vale. Our efforts to redeem ourselves in the eyes of Barath, or Barath, must be redoubled. So, about me being able to settle here? I can be sure of nothing right now. I advise you to get some rest, the inn, or a stable for all I care. Find me afterwards, I will know more soon enough. Look, if you're going to kill someone, you don't let them know you have a hate-on for them.
Were you looking for someone in that tree?
I could introduce you.
He looks up at the tree and breathes out. Half the town's up there now, seems like. No right way to talk about it. Look, I've got a problem in my head. Is there anyone up there who can help? He gives an understanding nod as he takes a long drag from his pipe. My condolences. He exhales and turns his attention away, watching the village around him. So, you're number two on the list. Bracelets of twine and bead, wilted flowers and notes half erased. It doesn't help me. I mean, the whispering is gone, but I still ain't right, you know? That's going to lead down. I'm just going to go ahead and... The long way it is. I'll talk to these guys on my own time. Let's see what this does. A rising sun and a three dawn stars, the symbol of Eothis. Even Celestial Pig is curious. Wretched beasts. A man lies resting against the wall, lit by the dim illumination of the fading sconces. He has a gaunt, fox-like aspect, and his face is pale and damp with sweat. He's dying. One arm is held loosely against his side, sleeves soaked with blood. He gives you an anxious glance as you near, his features twisted with pain.
Hello!
Ah, he's a godlike.
Like me!
Ha! Thought you were some... Never mind. Whoever you are, you've traveled a long way to reach a dark place. This temple isn't what it used to be, probably for the best, times being as they are. He groans and shifts position, wincing. I'm no looter, if that's what you're thinking. Not one of the faithful either. Just wanted to do some good, I suppose. I got my arm clawed up for it. Maybe you'd have better luck. Better luck with... The man points a finger upwards. These ruins around us used to be the temple of Eothis, the scattered god. A grand temple at that. His worshippers would come from all over Direwood. From Reed Saris? Not sure how to pronounce that. Until the war, of course. Even then, you get some of the stubborn ones. The ones that couldn't get it through their heads that their god was dead and gone. No. Please continue. Once the legacy started, Lord Radric decided he'd been too lenient on the Eothians. Nope, that's not it either. On the Eothasians? Yeah, that's it. He had his people go in and put them to the sword. Left them down there, buried under a heap of rock. After that, Radric ordered the temple sealed. It's been years like that up until recently. Lord Radric hopes that if we rededicate the temple to a living god, then we'll be forgiven, and the legacy will end. See? But until then, the temple is as you see it, unguarded. That's where you come in. WeArEuS? It has to be WeArEuS, right? WeArEuS licks his lips. Those priests... Maybe they didn't have a lick of sense between them, but they still didn't deserve to go like that. Chopped down in their god's house doesn't sit right with me. If you can get down there, find their remains, maybe we can finally give them a proper burial. No small task. There's coin in it for you, if you need motivating. Now, since you said money, I'm not super motivated. But you have my curiosity. Let's see. So, you're looking for some bones? I'd bury them where they are if I could. I know it's a little macabre, but if we don't get them out now, Radric's liable to destroy whatever's left of them. This is irrelevant. He's already explained his purpose here. Failed, as it is. They're long dead. It doesn't seem necessary to antagonize. I'm not going to go in just yet. We're going to hit that inn. That's above ground. By the flame, I owe you a good turn. But listen, the temple's been sealed off for so long, it's crawling with creatures. If it's been sealed off, how did they even get in? But if you get past them, the priests would have been down on the lower floor. They'll still be there, if they're anywhere. Those priests had all kinds of secret chambers, switches in the walls, trick sconces, and that kind of thing. Keep an eye out, and take care. Down there, I wouldn't want to have to send someone else after your remains. I'll wait here by the stairs. I expect nothing less. And keep a lookout. Maybe try to patch myself up some. Oh, look, he's all better.
Hello!
Okay, like I said, we're going to go back up above ground. Ladies and gentlemen, the tooltip has informed me we have a bestiary. This probably doesn't interest you a whole lot, but... right here. But it does interest me, because I would like the stats on that bear you managed to kill in the cave. Gonna just screw it. Well, hold on. Just in case this actually turns out to be stealing. Yoink. Well. The frick is this? Ah, now see the mask.
Quickly and quietly.
That indicates you're stealing. We won't be doing that right now. Wow, as you near, you feel a vibrant history contained in the essence of this woman's soul. Voices from his past seem to call out to you. Tickle, tickle. You see a key turn gently, steady, and hear a ghostly click as the door swings inward. Two figures slip in, locking the door behind them, and begin their prowl. Their hunt is efficient, and it takes them little time to acquire a sizable collection of documents and oddly shaped velvet pouches. Quick hands fill pockets, rucksacks, bags. The door opens downstairs, and everything freezes. Footsteps. A tired giggle. The thieves are all wide eyes and short breath as they empty their pockets of all but the necessities, anything noisy, hurriedly replaced. Silence from downstairs, then tentative steps up the staircase. A voice calls out. One thief creeps forward, the other gesticulating wildly for him to return. He continues forward, crouching by the banister. He sees a gaudy shoe and shoves. The woman falls with a cut-off scream, rolling lifelessly to the floor below. Swearing, the second thief grabs her brother and they make their escape, collecting whatever of value they can on the way out. So... is it him? No, this is a woman. As you near, you feel a vibrant history contained in the essence of this woman's soul. Touch it. You see a crowded marketplace, vendor stalls lining the road, the proprietors' voices calling out to passersby to come sample their wares. This woman wanders through the throngs, strolling hand in hand with another woman. They peruse the vendor's goods, tarrying at a book merchant with a number of old and beautiful tomes, chatting with one another about what they see. One will pick up a book and show it to the other, who will take it, comment on it, and place it back on its shelf. Then the first will snatch up the book again and quickly pay the merchant before the other can snatch it back. They walk away from the market, weighed down by packs filled with books, still hand in hand, standing close, comfortable, familiar with each other. As they pass down a somewhat deserted street, an object suddenly hits this woman in the chest and bounces off, rolling away towards one of the buildings. The women stop and look at the object, an apple, and then back up at the person who threw it. There's nothing special about him aside from the angry look on his face and the two other apples he holds. Before either woman can move, the man draws back and throws another one at them, this time hitting the second woman in the forehead. He yells at them something derisive and hateful, something about a legacy and responsibilities, and the woman raises her hand to her head and wipes the juice and bits of fruit from her face and stares at the man defiantly. The first woman squeezes her hand and puts the other on her companion's shoulder, attempting to calm her down. The other woman pulls a book from her pack and holds it before her, muttering under her breath, "Uh-oh." She pulls her hand free and waves it above the book and aura forming around her. The first woman is still trying to calm her down, but all she says goes unheard. The man, uncaring of the events happening in front of him, draws back and throws the last apple. As it arcs through the air toward them, the second woman brings up her hand and points at the apple. A glowing orb of energy flies from her hand and strikes the apple, causing it to explode, raining down bits upon the road and buildings around them. The man's face changes, anger joined by fear, looking like he's trying to decide if running or attacking is the better course of action. The second woman has started chanting again, her hand glowing, her eyes narrowing. This woman steps in front of her, placing herself between her love and their attacker. She touches her face, gently stroking it, while whispering calming words. A kiss. The woman's countenance changes. She calms, her eyes softening, her lips regaining the lost smile. The first woman smiles again as well and kisses the other. "Wizard scum," the man behind them says, and the two women turn to face him, staring him down defiantly. They join hands and begin walking again, moving past him without so much as a sideways glance. That's actually pretty cool. I wonder if I can pick
by my eyes are peeled.
Just waiting for the red circle to go. Oh, that's why it's...
Quickly and quietly.
I'm just trying to test a theory here on whether or not this red circle will go away if I'm outside of their range of vision. See, it should have started going away. Screw it, I'm out. A staple of the Direwood and countryside, goldrot chew is a favorite of farmers who swear by the minor boost in energy it provides. Those who use it often find that they feel sluggish when they stop. The chew is made from the root of the golden celery plant. Yoinkers. I don't need to wait.
My eyes are peeled.
The circle at my feet started filling, which means someone saw me. Right? Or no? and I'll be talking to all of these people on my own time.
My eyes are peeled.
Yoinky, yoinky. This man and woman appear to have been deep in conversation working at closing two bulging satchels. They move to embrace until the woman notices your approach and pauses, her smile faltering a little.
Good day, stranger.
The name Nonton is... This is the guy with the red cape, isn't it? I wonder how we should go about this. So they're packing for a trip, and apparently she's had her fill of this town. I don't want to kill them within the bounds of the city. I'm sure that's going to get some unpleasant looks from the locals. Let's try this out. Are you accusing him of something? Well, yeah. The spirit told me everything. She thinks, or is at least claiming, it. There's no way to know for certain yet whether she was in on it, but she apparently thinks it was a wild animal. It's a shame we don't have enough resolve. My friend, it was a cruel enough man to his friends. You didn't know him. You wouldn't defend him if you did. Let's see. She tells him to wait. I don't know what you saw in that cave, but this isn't what you think. Wait, this woman is his wife, the guy who was killed. I tried to leave the first time I suffered his temper, but he wouldn't have it. Okay, so these two fell in love. Oh, this is difficult. And in case it isn't known, we're trying to keep the character chaotic neutral. And don't bother to ask me to try and define how that works or how that is going to work. I have a general idea and that's all. Nothing I can actually put into words. Don't expect that kind of kindness regularly. just skimming this to see if it has anything to do with Pearly, because if I find out they lied to me, I will try to hunt them down and kill them both. Well, him at least. She probably didn't have anything to do with it. Anyway, let's see what else we've got here. There's nothing else here. What the frick did I just... You running around like an idiot. And speaking of which, where is that inn? We know there's more grain in there, Trumbull. We won't settle for scraps while you grow fat on our crops. A muffled shouting emerges from inside the mill. The first of you drunkards comes through that door gets a shot between the eyes. Gods, hear me, Swain, or I'll put you down like a dog. Come away for now, lads. We'll be back, Trumbull. And we'll have fair prices, or by the flame, we'll have a reckoning. Investigate the feud, huh? I'll get into that on my own. But now I want to find the inn. Maybe hallucinate a little. This will not be the inn. Oh, there it is, frickin' finally. You see four people gathered by the door to the inn, their raised voices and chopping gestures suggest an argument reaching its climax. The first figure raises his hand for calm. His face is partially obscured by a hood, but his height and stature suggest an elf.
I meant no offense. Let's put this matter to rest over a round, shall we? My treat.
Hoping to soothe our pride with a few Adira coppers, eh? We don't need your coin.
Ooh, a fight. One of the other men glares at the hooded elf. His eyes are red from drink, but his gaze is focused. You've got a lot of gall mocking us in our own village. We don't take ill treatment from foreigners, especially not Adirans. Aderans? No. Iderans? Especially not Iderans. Probably Aderans.
Go
whatever.
On. Say it again. I'm itching for an excuse.
Fie, you're itching for the kindling touch of your sister, you cocksfeather! I'll cut that barrel-looking tongue out of your head.
This is a misunderstanding. I didn't say... whatever it is you think I said.
We've nigh quarrel.
That's where you're wrong.
Hmm. look at each other. One of the men gives the other two a warning shake of his head before turning to you. We're done for now. But this one better watch his step around here, because we're not going anywhere. With a final scowl at the elf, he turns to leave. As the three stumble away, the elf turns to you, the tension almost gone from his smooth face.
Not quite how I hoped to get to know the neighbors. Thank you for your timely assistance with that awkward situation. Well, that is one way of putting it.
He straightens his hood and you note the remains of fraying embroidery on his gloves. His boots are caked with the dirt of many months' travel, but the leatherwork beneath it is sturdy and fine.
Well, I suppose introductions are in order after that little fiasco. Aloth Corvisser, at your service.
Corvisser, huh? Okay. So, why are you here? He laughs uncomfortably. That is something of a long story.
Well, I'm a wizard by training, and an adventurer by necessity. I was born in the Seathwood, part of the mainland of the Adir Empire, and both of my parents served the nobility, which afforded me an education for which I am grateful. However, there were no open positions in those houses, and so I decided to seek new means in a new land.
And ended up here.
And how exactly did you come to be here?
This isn't how things happened at all. Everyone died.
In Gwythyn Ruins? Well, those can be dangerous places during the best of times. Which these are not. In half the locals would arrest you for trespassing and the rest would kill you outright. I'm curious. What exactly did you find there? You do manage to find yourself in rather interesting predicaments.
You're one to talk.
I'm afraid that was a matter of misunderstandings and mistranslations. It doesn't help that people in these parts remember their war with Adir like it was yesterday.
Okay, so it's not Adir or Idir, it's... Wait. It's more like Adir. Yes. Ah, that. He clears his throat and adjusts his sleeves. As I tried to tell them, they misheard me. Happens all too easily after a few pints, and the accent doesn't help. For a moment, he looks as if he's about to say something else. Dang. His expression brightens with mischief. But before he can speak, he forces a tight smile, biting his lips so hard you expect to see blood. Finally, his face relaxes and he shakes his head. I should speak more clearly next time. My apologies.
An excellent question. I came looking for fresh air and cheap land. Instead, the magistrate gave me directions to the inn and a story about the local lord's expectant wife. But I take it that's a familiar tale.
Entirely sure we should trust this guy with that kind of... I mean, it's not really... Let's see what happens.
Indeed. The local lord has searched far and wide for similar specialists. He has rid himself of them almost as desperately. Begging your pardon, but neither do you. Yet, circumstances can find a person in the strangest of places.
Okay, I'll give you that. 1 point for that.
As should I, given recent events. It's just as well. A
I've had enough of the watered wine and lumpy beds at the inn. They say even the owner tired of the place. Just up and left one day. It explains quite a lot about the upkeep. Perhaps I could join you. I could use a change of scenery, and I find it's better to travel in numbers.
Okay. He seems like a bit of a troublemaker, but... Well, I'm a bit of a trouble finder, so... It's not like it'll hurt.
Excellent. I shall follow you.
So many people to talk to. Off camera, of course. This video's run so long, I'm sure. It's probably, what, an hour and a half by now? So let's find the cook and call it done. Pasca, that's the name. Hey, no.
Welcome.
Okay, so she recognizes us at once. Even though I'm pretty sure she's talking to... I forget the elf's name. But she's talking to the elf. Whatever, it's fine. Consider yourself a favorite of the house. Discounts on drinks, rooms. Tenfrith said he wanted to whip up something nice for you. He's already back to work in the kitchen. Well, this will be useful later on. I'll do some selling and buying later. For now, let's get a room. How much do we have? Only 100. Really? That's all we've picked up so far? I spent some, so we ended up getting like 80 over the course of our adventure, so yeah, this is fine. Your sleep is restless and fevered, assaulted by hisses and whispers, blanketed with suffocating anxiety. You open your eyes to awaken and find yourself in front of Gilded Vale's gallows tree, the creaking of its ropes growing louder in your mind until the sound is deafening. Hanging from the tree is an old dwarf woman whose face has shriveled inward like moldering fruit. Her head hangs limply to one side. As you look at her, she looms larger and larger in your mind until she is mere inches from your face. Suddenly, her head snaps up and her eyes open and they are empty, and behind them is a vast nothingness that makes your stomach drop. Her mouth slowly parts, and with a gust of rancid air, she speaks a word. Watcher. You jolt awake, the foul smell of the dwarf woman's breath still permeating your nostrils. Sweat runs down your face in thick droplets, and your skin is soaked from head to toe. You remember the woman. You remember seeing her decaying face when you spoke with the magistrate. He called her an animancer. Though it fills you with a new, queasy apprehension, you feel a strange compulsion to see this woman once more. If only to confirm she is truly dead.
Hmm?
And so we find today's video to be done. With our new companion, what's his name? Aloth. We'll soon be getting into something, I'm just certain of it. So if you've enjoyed what you've seen thus far, if you desire more, let me know down below by leaving a comment, leave a like, subscribe if you haven't. And with all that said, we will see you next time.